Each year, the program in creative writing at the University of Wyoming brings an eminent writer in residence to work with our students at the university, as well as to provide outreach to the state of Wyoming. This year's eminent writer in residence is Nam Lee. Nam was born in Vietnam and raised in Australia. His first book, a collection of short stories called The Boat, was a blockbuster. It was translated into 14 languages and received over a dozen major literary awards in North America, Europe, and Australia. The Boat was selected as a notable book or editor's choice by the New York Times, the Sydney Morning Herald, the Guardian of London, LA Times, Chicago Tribune, Miami Herald, Christian Science Monitor, Publishers Weekly, the list goes on. Nam Lee writes beautifully, but he also writes beautifully about terribly important things, and those two features are what drew our eye to him, as well as the third quality, and that is he is a gifted mentor and has been working very closely and very productively with our creative writing students. And so it's my pleasure to bring you this brilliant storyteller who will read from the title short story of his book, The Boat.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming out and thank you for having me. I'm thrilled to be here. I am, as Jeff said, thank you for the introduction, Jeff. I am going to read from The Boat, which is in The Boat. And because it's a kind of long story, I'm going to start it about halfway through. I reckon it kind of makes sense, or should do, as you pick it up. So here goes, The Boat. Once the storm passed, 6 days out, everything changed. Fishermen on the boat agreed that this storm had come on faster than any they'd ever experienced. It destroyed the caulking and much of the planking on the hull. The inboard was flooded, and soon afterward, both engines cut out completely. What food had been left was spoiled. Water was short. An Phuc, whose authority was never questioned, took charge of rationing the remaining supply, doling it out first to children, then the infirm, than everyone else. It amounted to a couple of wet mouthfuls a day. The heat was unbearable. Before long, the first body was cast overboard. Already a handful of people had been lost during the storm, but this was the first casualty witnessed by the entire boat. To the terrible, drawn-out note of a woman's keening, the bundle was tossed, a meek splash, into the water. Like everyone else, Mai looked away. After the storm, it seemed to Mai that a film had been stripped from the world. Everything became more intense, the sun hotter, the light more vivid, the sea darker, every word an affront to the new silence. The storm had forced people into their privacies. Children turned introverted, playing as though conducting conversations with themselves. Even time took on a false depth. The 6 days before the storm stretched out, merged with memory, until it seemed as though everything that had happened on the boat. A man burned his clothes to let up smoke. He was quickly set upon, the fire smothered. The longer they drifted, the more fearful they became of pirates. That night, another bundle was thrown overboard. And minutes later, they heard a thrashing in the water. It was too dark to see anything, yet, still, everyone averted their gaze. Thirst set in. Some people trapped their own urine. Some, desperate for drinkable water, even allowed themselves the quick amnesia and prayed for another storm. It was fantastic to be surrounded by so much water and yet be dehydrated. Mai soon realized she wouldn't make it. The day following the storm, she imitated some of the other youth, hauling up a bucket tied to the bowline. Under the noon sun, the seawater was the colour of amethyst. She drank it. It was all right at first. It was bliss. Then her throat started scalding and she wanted to claw it out. "You stupid girl," Quing reproached her, demonstrating how to use her fingers to induce vomiting. She hugged her fiercely. "Heavens, you can't wait? We're almost there." But what did Quing know? Mai had heard, how could she possibly have not, that other boats had successfully made the crossing in 2 days. She tried to sleep, to slide beneath the raw scour of pain in her throat. They'd been out 7 days. How much longer? Her father was persistent in her thoughts now. All these weeks, even months, he'd spent on this same sea, in trawlers much like this one. He'd been here before her. That afternoon when she awoke, her muscles felt as though they had turned to liquid. She could feel her heart beating slurpily. She followed the weakening palpitations, counterpointing them to the creak and strain of the boat, the occasional luff of the sail. The sun brilliant, but without heat. She was even thirstier than before. "I'm not going to make it," she said, and saying it touched the panic, brought it alive. "Don't speak," said Quinn. "Go back to sleep." Mai struggled into a half upright position. She made out a small group of children next to the bulwark and pressed her imagination to find him again, little Locke, her brother, turning with a snarl as he growled, "Dragon." She smiled, bit back tears. Behind him, her old school friend Hung was selling beef noodles in front of the damp, stink-shaded fish market. Straight through the market, she followed her daily route, picking up speed past fabric stalls and coffee yards, the dusty soccer field where sons of fishermen and truck drivers broke off from the game to buy cigarettes, and then to the wharf, her main place of business, among the taut, hard bodies crating boxes, the smell of fish sauce, the rattling talk of men, and the gleaming blue backs of silver fish, ice pallets, copper weighing scales bright in the sun, the bustle of docking and undocking, loading and unloading. A bare-chested man turned around and looked directly at her. "Ma?" It filled her with joy to see him like that, young and strong, his eyes clear and dead straight. He looked like he did in the altar photograph. It was her father before the war, before re-education, hospitalization. Back when to be seen by him was to be hoisted onto his shoulders, gripped by the ankles. His hands tough, saltish with the smell of wet rope. She moved toward him, she was smiling, but he was stern. "Child promised," he said. During his long absences at sea, she had lived incompletely, waiting for him to come back so they could tell to each other each moment of their time apart. "He spoiled her," her mother said. Her mother was right, and yet it changed nothing. Still, he went away, and still, each time, Mai waited. Her sudden, fervent anger startled her. "Why send child away? Child obeyed, Ma." Her mind sparked off the words in terrific directions. Child could have waited for Ma to get better. They had promised each other. He had left for 10 days and returned, strange and newly blind, after 2 years. A thought connected with another. It was Ma who left child. He stood there, tar-faced, empty-eyed, looking straight at her. She lifted her hands to her mouth, unable to believe what she had just said, the words still searing the length of her throat. "Child is sorry," she whispered. "Bad Ma sacrificed everything for child. Child knows, child is stupid." He would leap off the boat and swing her into the crook of his arm, up onto his shoulders. Her mother fretting her hands dry on her silken pants, smiling nervously. "I can't get it off me," he would say, his hands quivering on either side of Mai's ribcage. "It's stuck. I can't get this little beetle off me." She missed him with an ache that was worse, even, than the thirst had been. All she'd ever known to want was his return. So she would enjoy the gift of his returning and not be stupid. "Child is sorry." He didn't respond. "Child is sorry, Ma." "Mai." He was shaking her. She said again, "Child is sorry." Then she felt fingers groping around in her mouth, a polluting smell, and then her eyes refocused and she realized it was not her father she saw, but Trung, standing gaunt over her. "Thank heavens," came Huing's murmur. And looking at him, she finally understood, with a deep internal tremor, what it was that had drawn her to Trung, the boy, all this time. It was not, as she had first assumed, his age, his awkward build, nothing at all to do with Locke. It was his face. The expression on his face was the same expression she had seen on her father's face every day since he'd returned from re-education. It was a face dead of surprise. She gasped as the pain flooded back into her body. She was awake again, cold. "Mai's fever is gone," Queen said. She smiled at Mai, a smile of bright industry, such a smile as Mai had never hoped to see again. Unexpectedly, she was reminded of her mother, and to her even greater surprise, she found herself breaking into tears. "Good," whispered Queen. "That's good." Mai wiped her eyes, her mouth, with the hem of her shirt. "I'm thirsty," she said. She looked around for Truong, but he seemed to have slipped away. "You should be. You slept almost 2 days." It was evening. She stood up, Queen helping her, her legs giving at first. Slowly, she climbed up the hatch. On deck, she shielded her eyes against the sunset. An incandescent red sky veered into the dark ocean. Rows and rows of the same sun-blotched, peeling faces looked out at nothing. "Everyone's up here," Queen whispered, "because down there are all the sick people." "Sick people?" Mai checked the deck, then searched it again with growing unease. He'd been standing over her. Keeping her voice even, she asked, "Where is Truong?" "Truong? I don't know. But I saw him when I woke up." Queen considered her carefully. "He was very, very worried about you, you know." He wasn't in the clearing with the other children. Mai shuffled into the morass of arms and legs, heading for the pilot house. Nobody made way for her. At that moment, Truong emerged from the companionway. She almost cried out aloud when she saw him. Gone was the pale, delicate-faced boy she'd remembered. Now his lips were bloated, the skin of his cheeks brown, chapped in the pattern of bruised glass. An awful new wateriness in his gaze. He stood there warily as though summoned for punishment. Mai mustered her voice. "Is child well?" "Yes. Are you better?" "Truong, speak properly," scolded Queen. "How is Yi Mai?" "Well. Better." She leaned toward him, probing the viscosity of his eyes. His face's swollenness gave it a sleepy aspect. "Ma said Yi Mai was very sick. Yi is better now." "Dan and Ang were more sick than Yi," he said. "But Ma said they were lucky." Mai smiled at Queen. She hadn't heard him talk so much before. His voice came out scratchy, but steady. He stood before them in a waiting stance, legs together, hands by his sides. "Yi is glad for them." "They died," he said. When Mai didn't respond, he went on. "I saw the shark. All the uncles tried to catch it with that." He pointed to a cable hanging off the derrick crane, but it was too fast. "Truong!" His eyes flicked to his mother. Then he said, 14 people died while Yi Mai was sleeping." "Child." He brought up his hands by his sides, then opened them again. "Yi Mai isn't sick anymore, huh?" "That's right," Mai and Queen said together. It was difficult to reconcile him with his frail, wasting body. Seeing him, Mai's own body felt its full exhaustion. "Now, let's see," she said. She lifted one hand until it hovered between them, palm down. "You want to play slaps?" His black eyes stared at her with something akin to pity. "Pretend this is the shark," she exclaimed. Queen glanced up at her. Immediately, horrified, shocked by herself, Mai pulled back her hand. "Yi is just joking." Later that evening, a young teenage girl with chicken legs wandered over to the gunwale in an emotion like a bow that didn't stop, toppled gracefully over the side. "Wait," someone cried. "Let her be," another person said. "If she wants to, let her be." "Heaven, someone save her, someone," the first man stumbled to his feet, wild-eyed. "You do it, go on, jump." He stood like a scarecrow, frozen. Everyone watched him. He walked to the side and looked down at the shiny, dusk-reflecting water. "I can't see her," he said. "She must not have any family," Queen whispered to Mai. "She has the right idea," another low voice said. "Is there any better way to go?" "Tai," An Phuc said, coming over. "Tai, that's enough." Re-education camp. For 2 years, those two words had framed the entirety of her imaginative life. Her father, of course, hadn't talked about it when he returned, nor her mother. Now, for the first time, someone talked to her about it. An Phuc had fought in the same regiment as her father, had been sentenced to a camp in the same district. No, he hadn't known him. By the time the communists took Manmetut in March 75, the Americans were long gone and the southern regiments in tatters, soldiers deserting, taking cover as civilians, fleeing into the jungles. Escape on every man's mind. Soon they all learned there was no escaping the communists, not in the country they now controlled. They were skilled, he said, at turning north against south, village against village. He fell quiet. Mai waited. She watched him, remembering. 9 days had passed, and now she noticed how severely he had aged, his eyes gone saggy, his skin mottled with dark sunspots. In the camps, he said, they do what they do best. They take a man, and then they turn him against things. From the back deck, a middle-aged woman started wading in their direction through the sprawl of bodies. She held the port gunwale with both hands for balance. Husbands against wives, he went on. Children against parents. Your only chance is to denounce everyone and everything they tell you to. The woman reached them. She made her complaint in a hoarse voice. She was owed water. She attended hers to another child who had collapsed, she said, and pointed aft. Anfuk held Mai's eyes for a second, then followed the woman. Her father wouldn't have denounced her. She was sure of that, not in his own heart. But again, she understood how necessary it was to stay on the surface of things, because beneath the surface was either dread or delirium. As more and more bundles were thrown overboard, she taught herself not to look, not to think of the bundles as human. She resisted the impulse to identify which families had been depleted. She seized distraction from the immediate things, the weather, the next swallow of water, the ever-forward draw of time. Mai. It was Anfuk. She stood up, hauled herself on weak legs along the gunwale toward the rear of the boat. Past the hatch, she suddenly saw Trung, propped up against the rusty mast of the derrick crane, his chin drooping onto his chest, arms bony and limp by his sides. Mai leapt forward, swiping her elbows and knees from side to side to clear space. The surrounding people watched listlessly. Water! No one reacted. She looked around and spotted an army flask, grabbed it, swiveled the cap open, held it to his mouth. A thin trickle ran over his rubbery lips before the flask was snatched away. She looked up and saw a man's face, twisted in hate the moment he struck her, his knuckles hard as a bottle against her cheek. She fell over and covered Trung's body. She stole water. I'll pay it back, said Anfuk, roughly. Trung started coughing. Mai sat back, her cheek burning, and mumbled apology in the direction of the man. He was picking the flask up from the ground. People glanced over, disturbed by the waste. There had been a minor outcry the previous evening when a woman, an actress, people said, had used the last of her ration to wash her face. Trung squinted up at Mai. Everything about him, the dark sore of his face, his disproportioned skeletal limbs, seemed to be ceding its sense of solidity. She touched his blistered cheek with her fingers, was reminded of the sting on her own cheek from the man's blow. Ma? He wheezed. It's all right, she said. Ma is coming, geez, here. Where's Quing? Asked Anfuk. He stood up quickly and walked off. Trung said, I wanted to count the people. He coughed again, the air scraping through his throat. Watching him, a helpless feeling welled up within Mai and started to coalesce at the front of her skull. Child, she whispered. Quing arrived. She seemed to be moving within a slower state, her face drawn, hair tangled. She saw Trung and bent down to him. Look, she murmured, you hurt yourself. He fainted, said Mai. Anfuk leaned down close to both of them. Come with me, he muttered. They followed him forward to the pilot house, everyone watching as they passed. Once inside, he closed the door. Carefully, he measured out a capful of water from a plastic carton and administered it into Trung's mouth. The sight, even the smell, of the water roused an appalling ache in Mai's stomach, but she said nothing. Good boy, said Anfuk. Quing's eyes followed the carton. Is that all there is? Holding the tiller with one hand, he reached down and opened the cupboard beneath it. 3 plastic white cartons. That's all, he said, unless it rains. The 10th day dawned. Engines dead, the boat drifted on, grey shadows strafing the water behind it. The detachable sail hoisted onto a short mast's yard, and men taking turns, croaking directions to each other as they tried to steer the boat as best they could to the south. Mai watched Trung with renewed intensity. Since Mai's recovery, Quing had kept to herself, remaining huddled during the day as well as night underneath the companionway stairs where they all slept. That morning, Mai had found her sitting in the slatted light, staring vacantly into the dark hold, squeezed between two old women. "How is Trung?" Quing asked her quietly. Mai said, "I keep telling him to come down. He doesn't like it down here." Mai nodded, not knowing what to say. Quing dropped her chin and closed her eyes. Mai looked her over. She didn't look sick. "Is Gi all right?" Quing nodded, almost impatiently. One of the women beside her spat into her hands. When Quing looked up, her face was distant, drawn in unsparing lines. "Look after him, please." Above deck, each hour stretched out its hot minutes. Mai lay on her back under the derrick crane, her head against someone's shin, limbs interwoven with her neighbour's. Trung wedged beside her. The crane cast a shadow that inched up their bodies. She threw her sleeve over her face to ward off the sweltering sun. At one point a wind blew in and the boat began to sway lightly in the water. She was riding her father's shoulders, her mother watching them happily. Whenever he was home, he brought with him some quality that filled her mother so that there was enough left, sometimes, for her to be happy. Trung started singing, softly, to himself, so softly she wouldn't have heard him if her ear hadn't been inches from his mouth. She gradually shifted her arm down so she could hear better. He sang the ballad from the third night. She listened, hardly daring to breathe, watching the now darkening sky knitting together the rigs and cables of the crane above them as though they were the branches of trees. When he finished, the silence that surged in afterward was unbearable. Mai reached across her body and gently took hold of his arm. "Who taught child how to sing like that?" He didn't answer. The next morning, back below deck, she woke up to find a puddle of vomit next to his curled up sleeping body. It gleamed grey in the early light of dawn. "The child has the sickness," a voice said without a second thought. It was one of the old women who had camped with them beneath the stairs. The hatch was open and light flowed in like a mist, dimly illumining the three other bodies entangled in their nook. The deeper recess of the hold remained black. "No, he doesn't," said Mai. "Poor child, he is not the last. Such a pity." "Be quiet!" Mai covered her mouth, abashed, but no one reproached her. Several bodies stirred on the other side of the stairs. Barely awake, Quing rolled over to her son and propped herself up on an elbow. She brushed his cheek with her knuckles. For a second, in the half-light, Mai thought she saw an expression of horror move across her friend's face. "Child is sorry," Mai murmured to the old woman. Trung's eyes were glazed when he opened them. He looked like a burnt ghost. He leaned over, away from his mother, and dry-retched. There was nothing left in him to expel. Another of their neighbours, a man who smelled of stale tobacco, averted his legs casually. "What it can do to you," the old woman said, her gums stained crimson from chewing betel leaves. "The ocean." "Does child's stomach hurt?" asked Mai. "Yes." "What it can steal from you and never give back. My husband, both my daughters." "It's just a stomach ache," said Quing, and then looked up as though daring the old woman or anyone to disagree. A gang of eyes, unmoving, inexpressive, watched them from the shadows. That evening, An Phuc ladled out the last rations of water. He shuffled wearily through the boat, repeating the same account to anyone who stopped him, intoning his interlocutors' names as though that were the only consolation left him to offer them. Weak moans and thick silences trailed him. When Mai poured her ration into Trung's cup, Quing frowned and then flinched away. "Thank you," she said at last. For the first time, she used the word for younger sister. "It's nothing, I already took a sip." "Poor child," repeated the old woman, shaking her head. Trung took some water in, then coughed some of it out. People looked over. In the dusk light, his face was pallid and shiny. He opened his mouth. "Ma," he said. "I'm here," said Quing. Quing bit her lips, wiped the sweat from Trung's brow with the corner of her shirt. Finally, his eyes focused, and he seemed to look straight at Mai. "It's so hot," he said. "Tai," said Quing, dabbing above his eyes, around his hairline. "I want to go up." "Sleep, my beloved. Sleep." Mai wanted desperately to say something to him, something useful or comforting, but no words came. She got up to close the hatch door. The old woman took out a betel leaf and inserted it into the slit of her toothless mouth. His sickness followed the usual course, muscle soreness and nausea in the early stages. That evening, his blisters began to rise, some of them bleeding pus. He became too weak to swallow water. In the middle of the night, Mai woke to find Trung half draped over her stomach, his weight on her so light as to be almost imperceptible, as though his body were already nothing more than bones and air. "Everything will be fine," she whispered into the darkness, her thoughts still interlaced with dream, scattered remotely across space and grey sea. Back home, she'd slept on the same mat as Locke, her mother by the opposite wall. She reached down and touched Trung's brow. He stirred awake. "Is child all right?" "I want to go up." The skin on his face was hot and moist. Mai lifted her eyes and noticed Quing, mashed in the shadow of the companionway steps, staring at both of them. "Take him," she said dully. Mai found a spot for them by the pilot house, surrounded by sleeping families. When dawn came, Trung's head slid with a slight thunk onto the planking. Half asleep, Mai sought his shoulder, shook it. His body gave no response. She sat up and shook him again, his clothes stiff with dried sweat. "Nothing." "Trung," whispered Mai, feeling the worry build within her. She poked his cheek. It was still warm, thank heavens, it was still warm. She checked his forehead, hotter than it had been last night. He was boiling up, his breath shallow and short. With agonizing effort, she cradled his slight, inert body and bore him up the stairs into the pilot house. Unfuk was slumped underneath the tiller, sleeping. Three infants were laid out side by side on the floor, swaddled in rags. The next morning, the morning of their 13th day, a couple of the fishermen sighted land. A swell of excitement, like a weak current, ran through the boat. People looked at one another as though for the first time. "We made it," someone quietly announced, returning from deck. He paused on the companionway, his head silhouetted against the sunlight. In the glare, Mai couldn't make out his face. He said, "We're safe now," his words deep in his throat. Quing and Trung were underneath the stairs. Mai had left them to themselves during the night. Now, with those others strong enough, Mai followed the man above deck. Outside, the dawn sun steeped through her, as though her body were made of paper. Dizziness overwhelmed her when she saw the half-empty deck. Had they been so depleted? She thought, with an odd pang, of Trung, his incessant counting. Then she saw the prow, teeming with people, all peering ahead, attitudes stalled in the necks and shoulders. She made her way forward, then spotted, far ahead, the tiny breakers on the reef, and behind those, the white sand like a bared smile. Birds hanging in midair over the water. Nearly weightless in her body, Mai descended the companionway. When she reached the bottom, she spun and searched behind the stairs. There they were, the hold awash with low talk. "Yu Wing." She was about to call out again when she sensed something amiss. Quing's back folded over Trung's sleeping form. It was too stiff, the posture too awkward. Mai moved closer. "Yi?" she asked. Quing's crouched torso expanded, took in air. Without turning around, she said, "What will I do now?" Her voice, brute, flat, Mai squatted down, her heart tripping faster and faster up into her throat. Quing said he didn't. She said all night he wouldn't wake up. She was wrong, thought Mai. What did she know, thought Mai, when she'd left last night, he had been recovering. He'd been fine. What could have happened? Quing shifted to one side. He was bundled up in a blanket. The bundle tapered at one end, where his legs must have been. Mai could see no part of him. How could this be the end of it? She wrung the heels of her hands into her eyes, as if the fault lay with them. Then she felt Quing's face, cool with shock, next to her own, rough and wet and cool against her knuckles, speaking into her ear. At first she recoiled from Quing's touch. What was she saying? She was asking Mai for help. She was asking Mai to help her carry him. It was time, she said. Time, which had distended every moment on the boat until there had seemed to be no shape to it, seemed now to snap violently shut, crushing all things into this one task. They were standing. When had they gotten up? Then they were kneeling, facing each other over the length of him. Quing, circumspect in her movements, as though loath to take up any more space than her son now needed. She seemed not to see anything she looked at. Together, the two of them brought the bundle aft through the shifting, silent crowd, past the derrick crane, where a group of the strongest men waited. There, the wind turned a corner of the blanket over and revealed the small head, the ash beauty of his face, the new dark slickness of his skin. With a shudder, Quing fell to it and pressed and rubbed her lips against his cheek. Unfook, standing with three other men, waited for Quing to finish before touching her shoulder. He said, to no one in particular, "We'll make land soon." And as though this were an order, Mai took Quing's arm and led her the full span of the boat to the prow. Again, the crowd parted for them. They stood together in silence, the spray moistening their faces as they looked forward, focusing all their sight and thought on that blurry peninsula ahead, that impossible place, so that they would not be forced to behold the men at the back of the boat peeling the blanket off, swinging the small body once, twice, three times before letting go, tossing him as far behind the boat as possible so he would be out of sight when the sharks attacked. Thank you. So I'll just take questions here.
I think you're ready to answer questions.
Sure, yeah. Please.
What inspires your book?
Well, the book is a collection of short stories. Each of the stories, I guess, arose from a different inspiration. But that particular story, which actually I've never read that much of in public before, I guess was inspired by my family's experience. We left Vietnam on a boat. I didn't really get a lot of the story until much, much later on in my life, and I had to piece it together through various accounts. And so at one stage, I sort of knew that it was always a story that I would have to write, even though it's the story that I'm expected to write, and I don't like to do what people expect me to do. But I realized I would probably have to do it at some point. And so it was tough going for various reasons, but it's done at least.
Why does Mai use the word child when she's thinking in her mind of talking to her father?
Yeah, it's really tricky from a fictional writer's point of view to transpose that into English, because the idea of pronouns as we understand them in English are very, very different in Vietnamese. And there's no universal you. You don't address someone as you. You address them by their relationship to you. And so that you changes with respect to whatever situation you're in and whoever you're talking to. And the same thing goes for I. And so there's so much meaning that can be wrapped up in how you address someone, because it talks to your assumptions about them, the station that you elevate them on, or sort of, put them on beneath you, and also how you talk about yourself indicates so much about your state of mind and what's happening in that moment. So, I mean, it, it's 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 almost impossible to convey that in English. But there's, I still think it's a little bit clumsy the way that it's done, but I can't really think of another way at this point to do it without sort of adding a lot of different terms, which would just make it confusing for a reader.
I liked it.
Cheers. Child, thanks you.
Well, Norm, thank you very much.
Not at all. Thanks, guys.